Life can be heavy, a burden which at times seems unbearable. It's easy to find ourselves overwhelmed, weighed down, or even crushed. Often these struggles come and go, a nuisance, an annoyance, yet sometimes they grab a hold, gripping every aspect of our lives, pulling us down, consuming our hope. It's hard to breathe under the weight of our anxieties. It's difficult to move forward when we're anchored to our worries. But God loves us too much to let us stay this way. He wants to replace our anxiety with hope, our fear with courage, our worries with peace, and our burdens with freedom. In moments when life begins to weigh you down, remember this one simple truth. We serve a faithful God, a God who's offered to carry our burdens and asks us to cast all our cares on Him.
Good morning, good morning, Victory. What's going on?
Good morning.
Oh my gosh, that was so weak. We're going to try that again. Good morning, Victory. What's going on?
Good morning.
Okay, a little bit better. I'm so glad that you guys came and joined us today for worship. Man, that hope, that peace, that courage, that freedom that we have in Christ, that's what we're going to be singing about right now. So I'd love to invite you to rise as we worship our Lord.
It's gonna be alright, 'cause I know my Let's sing this next song, Homecoming.
Shackles I wear, I bought on my own. Scarlet sins had a crimson cost. He nailed my debt to that old rugged cross. An empty slate at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was rolled away. Lord, I confess I've been the prodigal, made for your house, but walk my death came alive when he called me by name. Scarlet sins had a crimson cost. He nailed my debt to that old rugged cross. An empty slate at the empty grave. Thank God that stone was rolled.
Bright crimson robes.
I see bright crimson robes draped over the ashes, wide open tomb where there should be a casket. The children are singing and dancing and laughing. The Father is welcoming. This is our homecoming. Roses in bloom pushed up from the embers. Rivers of tears flow from good times. Singing and dancing and laughing. The Father is welcoming. This is our homecoming. Heaven joins in with the glorious sound. And the great cloud of witnesses all gather round. Cause the ones that were lost are finally found. The Father is welcoming. This is our homecoming.
Scarlet sins had a crimson. This is our
Good morning, Victory. How are we doing today? I think they like me a little bit better. I don't know. Just a feeling. And I got to say, that song is a banger. I mean, it always has me feeling some kind of way. That's a good, good song. So let's go ahead and kick things off. First things first, if you're a newcomer here, we'd like to welcome you. We have a little gift prepared for you. Right in the back, we have Victory tumblers. Those are our gift to you if you're a newcomer. Now, as we look towards this right over here, it's very important. I've been talking about this probably for, I think, like 2-3 months now or something like that. So you can tell it's very important. This is our church program. We're handing these out to everybody who comes into our church service. It's a great way to stay in contact with us and stay on top of everything going on in our church community. Right here, we have a communication card. Here's a way to get plugged in, ask for information regarding fellowship groups, and also prayer requests. We invite and we encourage, heavily encourage, everybody to fill one out. That way we can go ahead and stay plugged in. Now, as we go ahead and kick things off with the VBS announcement specifically, VBS is going to be kicked off July 20th. It's going to be July 20th to the 22nd. It's going to be at Anaheim First Christian. It's going to be a great time of fellowship for all of the kiddos. So one thing, as I'm sure everybody here knows, since I don't see any kiddos specifically here, but we were all once kiddos ourselves, it's great to be among people our own age, especially when we're young kiddos. And that way we can go ahead and have fun while also being in a Christ-centered community. Now, if we're going to go ahead and look a little bit ahead of time to July 24th, that's going to be our VBS Sunday. So that's going to be basically the culmination of all the VBS activities. Right after Sunday service, we're going to have a great time of fellowship and community building right outside in the patio. We're going to have hot dogs, snow cones. I think I call dibs on the first snow cones because those things are delicious. We have like a little bottle of a thing called Tiger Blood. That thing smacks. So go ahead and join us for that. Now, one last thing that's very important, to serve in your church community. I know many of us could be sitting down there thinking, oh boy, yeah, that's just for Morgan. Oh no, that's just for David. I don't want to do that. If you have air in your lungs, you have a ministry to accomplish. So I encourage you. It doesn't have to be speaking in front of people. It doesn't have to do anything like that. As simple as just helping with setup, helping with greeting people as they come in, those are ways that you can go ahead and stay plugged into the church community. So I'll go ahead and pass this off to Pastor Dave.
Thanks, Morgan. So just want to take a few moments to go ahead and go to the Lord with our giving right now. We are thankful to the Lord, and giving is an expression to give back to God and say, Lord, thank you for your goodness in our lives. And so in our church, you can give two ways. One, through our online platform at victoryanaheim.org/donate. It's a secure platform. Or we have the giving box in the back of the room as well. So God bless you as you give. I want to take a moment now and observe the Lord's Supper. And so I'm going to read from the book of Matthew when Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper. You know, communion is one of these things that it's one of the practices that we do as believers that we sink into the Christian faith. We jump into unity together in Christ by our practices. And the Lord's Supper is a reminder of Jesus' sacrifice on our behalf. And so when Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper, he was with the disciples in the upper room just before his death and resurrection. And in Matthew chapter 26, verse 26 through 28, it says this. Now they were eating. As they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples, and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many, for the forgiveness of sins. So the Lord's Supper, we observe it as a remembrance of Jesus' death and his sacrifice on our part, and so that we might have life with God. Something that isn't so common in our world is to talk about sin and the effects of sin on our lives. And yet Jesus, he said right there in those verses, he said that his blood is for the forgiveness of sins, and so that we might remember. So I want to invite you to come as you're ready, as the band sings this next song, and you can come up and either take by yourself, or if you want to take with someone you're with, a friend, a family member, your spouse, just take the next few moments and observe the Lord's Supper. Remember Jesus' sacrifice for our sins. God bless you as you partake of the Lord's Supper.
Offer this heart, oh God,
Thanks, worship team. That was beautiful. I like that song, The Stand. Some of us have had a week. I talked to some folks among us that had a rough week. I talked to some folks that aren't here. Have you noticed that, like, COVID is back a lot? I can think of about four people in our church right now that I've talked to that got COVID, so they're not here today. Otherwise, they'd be with us. They're laying low. They're fine, but they don't want to spread it. And talked to some folks who just had a rough week relationally with family, at work. Things didn't go well. And sometimes that's how it goes. You have those weeks. It's a bad week. It's a rough time, and you're discouraged. And you're like, man, can't wait for this week to be over. Can't wait for this month to be over. There are those times that come. But here's the good news. You already know this. This will pass. It will pass. The hard time will pass, and the times of refreshing are coming. Anyone here need to be refreshed by God?
Every day.
Every day. Amen. Amen. That's my wife. Whose heart needs renewal? Mine does. If that's you, I want to say this. As a Christian, you came to the right place. When your heart needs renewal, you go where God's people are. You go where people are there to worship the living God and to lift up the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross for us. The church, among the church, is where the Spirit of God flows. Among the people of God. Jesus even said, where two or more are gathered in my name, there I am in their midst. We welcome you here, Holy Spirit. You're welcome in this place. We welcome you here, Jesus. We thank you, Father in heaven, for sending the Holy Spirit, for sending Jesus. People of victory, this is your time to be refreshed. Will you join me as we pray? Our God and our Father, we thank you for your goodness and your love and your power. Lord, we need them in our lives. We need the renewal that comes from seeking you, that comes from obeying you, that comes from abiding in you, Jesus. And Lord, in these few moments we have together, Lord, we anticipate the movement of your Spirit among us to renew our hearts and refresh our souls. And Lord, we welcome you here. And we ask, Lord, that you help us to receive your word as we delve into it right now. Amen. This is week 3 of our current series, going through the book, The Acts of the Apostles. And in each week of this series, we're bringing a message from from each chapter of the book of Acts. There are 28 chapters, so each week we're bringing a message from the chapter. And so I want to set up this message by telling you there was a man. He was paralyzed from birth, and since he could not work, each morning his friends carried him to where the most people were so he could beg for money. They carried him to the entrance of the temple in Jerusalem. They set him down at a certain place called the Beautiful Gate, and it's this colonnade with a bunch of columns evenly spaced together at the Beautiful Gate. Also called Solomon's Portico, where he begged worshipers for alms. And as it happened, two men passed by him on this particular day. And they were on their way to pray in the temple. And the man looked humbly down, not even making eye contact with them. He looked at the ground while just saying, alms for the poor, alms for the poor. But on this day, at this time, and those men, He was going to experience something that he had never experienced every day as he went to the temple to beg for money. These two men did two things that no one else had ever done as he begged them, as he begged for money. And he sat there every day, day in and day out, begging for money. And the first thing that these men did is one of them said to him, they went to get his attention for him to look them in the eyes. And he said, "Look at us. Look at us." And most people who passed by this man just passed by, paying no attention to him. And so even those who gave, they just laid down some money and kept going in. Few ever engaged him in conversation. But these men said, "Look us in the eye. Look us in the eye." And the men respected his dignity as a fellow human being, born in the image of God. And then the men uttered words that paralyzed man would never forget for the rest of his life. They uttered these words, or this one of the men said this, "I have no silver or gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise and walk." And then he held out his hands and grabbed that man by his right hand and lifted him up. And his feet grew strong and his ankles grew strong. And he leapt to his feet and he began to walk with them. And he walked into the temple with them, praising God that he could walk, that he met these men on this particular day. Now, people who were all around stood amazed at what they just saw. And then word got out. Everybody had seen this man begging day in and day out. And word got out, that guy that sits there begging, these two guys just said, "Rise and walk," and he started walking. This formerly paralyzed man, he walked, he leaped, and he praised God that he could do these things. He walked into the temple with the two men arm in arm. Those two men were named Peter and John. They were among the inner circle of the three closest to Jesus among his disciples. It was about 6 months after Jesus' death. This took place about 6 months after Jesus was crucified and miraculously raised from the dead and seen by hundreds of his followers. And then the Holy Spirit came on the 120 who waited in prayer. As Jesus told them, "Go and wait in Jerusalem for the Holy Spirit to come." And the Holy Spirit came. And that was recorded in Acts chapter 2. And it was on the day of Pentecost when the Spirit fell on those 120. And the power they exercised, Peter and John exercised on this day, was a result of the Spirit falling on them on the day of Pentecost. Now today's message is called Times of Refreshing. Times of refreshing, because we all go through seasons where we need to be refreshed. We all go through times where we need to hear from God and we need God to work in our lives and to renew our hearts and our spirits and our drive and our passion for life. And in this message, we're going to look at what happened after Peter and John healed this man in Acts chapter 3. So the focus of my message is going to be starting on Acts chapter 3, starting at verse 11 through 20. And so I want to ask you to join me as we take a peek into what happened after this man was healed. First, in verse 11, it says this: while he being the man who had formerly been paralyzed, while he clung to Peter and John, all the people were utterly astounded, and they ran together to them in the portico called Solomon's. The man who was healed clung to Peter and John. They had just given him a second chance to fully live. When that man was born many years earlier, surely his parents, when they held the new baby, they think of all the potential and all the joy that a family has when the new baby arrives. And all the, a baby is a picture of hope for everyone. Everyone who sees a new baby sees the hope of future potential in that baby. And so that's why children are so important, that we have children and we experience the joy that children have. So that's why God said to Adam and Eve, he said, go into all the earth, be fruitful and multiply. And that's why the Lord said to the children of Israel who were taken into captivity in Jeremiah chapter 29, when they were captive in Babylon, the Israelites, and the Lord said, be fruitful and multiply in Babylon. Do not decrease in number, increase in number. Give your sons and daughters into marriage. Have babies, multiply. Do not decrease. And that's been the call for God's people forever. Go be fruitful and multiply. Increase and do not decrease. And so the hope that these parents had for this little child was crushed when his body was paralyzed and he could never walk. And so he was dependent on people all the days of his life. And these were days before there were even wheelchairs. So people had to carry him around to get him to the place. He was completely dependent on others to get him where he wanted to go. But on this day, he got a second chance at that hope that comes with life. And so it was like he got a new life on that day. And so there was a lot of joy and a lot of hope in this man's heart. When God does something in our lives, we experience the power of God. When we experience the power of God to break through barriers in our lives, when we experience that hope that comes from answered prayer, that hope that comes from healing, that hope that comes from a new lease on life, there's one important thing that God's people need to always do when we experience the power of God in our lives. It's a very important thing, and it's pivotal that we not neglect to do this important thing. That is the responsibility of every Christian who experiences the power of God in their life. We need to do like what this man did. We need to testify about the greatness of God, because others need to hear about the greatness of God, just like this man testified. It says that he leapt to his feet and he walked into the temple praising God for what God had done and telling others what God had done in his life. When we're witnesses to God's power, to God's strength, when the Lord works in our life, it's our duty to tell others about it. People need to know that God is at work. People need to see his handiwork. Why do you think it's important that people need to know God's work? Because the power of God brings hope. The power of God brings hope. It breathes new life into dry bones. God's power disseminates despair, and it cultivates freedom and human dignity and creativity. God's power brings hope. Wherever God is at work, there is hope, there is life, there is creativity, there is love. Well, moving on, I'm gonna read this section called The Name of Jesus, from verses 12 through 16. But I want to say this first, that Peter was the one who spoke healing into this man's life. It was Peter who spoke healing into this man's existence. But Peter did not do the healing himself. It was the power of God through him. Peter did have something to say. Peter knew he needed to interpret after these people had seen this healing, all right? These people had witnessed this great healing, and Peter did not stop with just the healing. Peter, the healing was done through Peter, but Peter interpreted the healing. And that's an important thing. Peter knew he needed to interpret it, the work of God for this crowd. And so he began preaching the second sermon of Peter recorded in the book of Acts. In Acts, actions often lead to an explanation of what God is doing. Words and actions go together. So after the healing of this man who was born unable to walk, Peter preached, and we see it in verses 12 through 16. I'm going to read right now. And when Peter saw it, starting with verse 12, and when Peter saw it, he addressed the people. Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our power or our piety we have made him walk? Verse 13. And the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. Verse 14, but you denied the holy and righteous one and asked for a murderer to be granted to you. Verse 15, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. Verse 16, and his name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given this man this perfect health in the presence of you all. It's interesting what Peter said here. Peter took no credit for the healing whatsoever. Did you pick up on that? Peter took zero credit for the healing. So God used Peter as a conduit for healing, but Peter doesn't want to take any credit for himself. Peter doesn't want to be famous. He wants to talk about Jesus. He wants to point to the famous one. He wants for people to give glory to God. Anytime you see great things happen by the power of God, one important thing to note is who gets the credit. Who gets the credit? We know, if we're talking about politicians, when we see great things happen, politicians are going to be going like, my policies, look what I did, I get the credit. But then we get, whenever things go bad, they go like, it's not my fault, their fault. Previous administration, those people, that country, Russia, whoever. Notice what happens when great thing, or what, like who gets the credit when great things happen. Pay attention to that, especially in the church, because the temptation in the church is just as real as in the world for people to take the glory away from God. That temptation is in the church just as much as in the world, because we're human. And so Peter set a great example here. He did not take the credit. And it's an important question to ask that do leaders, Christian leaders, take the credit for God's work? The greatest mark of godly leaders is that they are both strong and that they are humble. Their confidence is high and they have a realistic view of how they're being used by God in the world to do the will of God. But they do the work of God without trying to take the credit for themselves. That's an important thing for God's people to do. In verses 13 through 15, Peter wasn't holding back in his message. It's really powerful what Peter did here, because three times in this passage, Peter points out to, he's speaking to people of Israel who would have been there when Jesus was crucified and who would have been there when Pilate was saying, who should I release, Jesus or Barabbas? And they said, give us Barabbas. Crucify Jesus. And when Pilate said, but this is King of the Jews, and they said, we have no king but Caesar. They're God's people The people of God were saying, nope, we have no king but Caesar. They were choosing Caesar in that moment over the King of Kings. Amazing. They chose a dictator over the King of Kings. And that's how it is in the world, because our eyes are blinded by the lies of this world. Well, Peter wasn't holding back, because three times in this message, he points out to the Jewish people who are his audience that they rejected Jesus, the one who was sent by the Father to bring abundant life. In verse 13, Peter said, Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate. In verse 14, Peter said, you denied the holy and righteous one. And then in verse 15, he said, you killed the author of life. Peter was not holding back with these people. He was confronting them with what really happened, which they were witnesses to and they took part in. Peter directly and repeatedly told the Jewish people that they were responsible for Jesus' imprisonment, for his death, and that they needed to repent before God. It's not easy to proclaim truth. Say that with me. It's not easy to proclaim truth. When it hurts people to hear truth, and people don't want to receive truth, it also is difficult for the preacher to preach truth. And it's never easy to speak truth. It's always hard to speak truth. And but I want to point out why we make preaching the center of our, or the center point of our Sunday services. When the preacher preaches, when someone's here preaching to God's people, there are three reasons that we preach. First, to proclaim the truth of God. Second, to confront lies of the enemy. And third, to change lives by calling them to Christ. Those are the three reasons why we preach. Those are the three reasons why we have preaching at the center of our Sunday gatherings. And we need to hear truth every day. And we need to receive truth every day. To the extent that we can embrace hard truths is also the extent that we can make hard changes in our lives. Those who will pay the price by doing the hard work of confronting lies and adopting truth, their lives will be transformed by the power of God. Their lives will be transformed and reformed and reborn into a life filled with God's presence and God's power and the Holy Spirit. In verse 16, Peter pointed out that in the name of Jesus, he brought healing to this man. He said, by the name of Jesus, this man was healed, making him strong and giving him perfect health, Peter said. But I want to note this, that it was not the faith of the man who sat there begging that healed him. It was not the faith of the man who begged that healed him. It was the faith of Peter who healed the man. Peter's faith healed the man. Remember what Peter said to the man? He said, I don't have silver and gold, but what I do have, he said, look at me. What I do have, I'm giving to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. It was all Peter's faith that healed this man. And it is Jesus who imparts such faith into his people. You might go, man, I don't have that kind of faith that I would believe that have you ever prayed that God would heal someone? Do you have the faith to pray? You know how sometimes we hedge our prayers and we'd be like, well, God, I pray that the doctors do a great job. But we're not praying for healing. We're praying for the doctors to do a great job. You see, we go, well, God works through doctors. I guess that's how we're thinking. God works through doctors these days, right? Well, God can work through doctors. But God can work through his people filled with the Holy Spirit too, who have faith. And I think that Peter is setting an example here. Peter goes, man, I don't have money, but I'm going to see and give you what I have. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And I think Peter sets a great example for us that sometimes the greatest barrier to God's work in our lives is our lack of faith. It's that we don't believe in the power of God to do something that we need done and that we see that's impossible to have done. So Christians themselves can be a wall to experiencing the breakthroughs of God because we lack faith. And that when the barrier is us, we live in a world where it's common for people to lack faith in God. Doubt, timidity, and fear will all squash the movement of God. When we doubt ourselves, when we doubt God, it will squelch the work of God in our lives. It won't squelch the power of God, but God's not going to work through your doubt. God's not going to work through your timidity. And God's not going to work through your fear. He'll help you overcome your fear and your timidity and your doubt, but you've got to overcome it so that you're walking in step with the Spirit of God. That's a big deal for God's people. And these times that we're in, even the strongest Christians I know, I see them waver in their faith. When your faith wavers, it's usually for one of these reasons. Someone has confronted you and you weren't ready for it. It's like Peter, when he was gathered around a fire after Jesus was on trial, as he was about to be crucified. And Jesus had predicted it. Peter, you're going to deny me three times before the cock crows in the morning. Peter goes, no way, Lord, no way. I'll never deny you, Lord. Here it was, hours later. All that had transpired that night. It's recorded in Mark chapter 14 that Peter's gathered around a fire and people start confronting him. You're one of his followers. Peter, I don't know him. Three times, I don't know him. Even the third time, so strongly, he cussed when he made the point. I don't know Jesus. And sometimes you might be confronted and you're not ready for it, and it causes you to doubt. Somebody says something, and it chips away at your faith, and you become a doubter. You used to be so strong, and you used to have such strong faith, but you become a doubter because your guard was down, and you weren't ready for what's hitting you now. Another reason why people lose faith is a situation happens, you were praying for a different outcome, and the outcome that you prayed for did not happen. In fact, the worst outcome possibly that could happen happened. And you go, God, where are you? And that may cause you to doubt. That happened with Elijah in 1 Kings chapter 18 when he was the lone, what he thought, the lone prophet in Israel of God. And he spoke boldly in the name of the Lord God. And there was this contest that he set up among the 400 prophets of Baal. And the 400 prophets were begging their God to answer by fire, by consuming the bull, the sacrificial bull. And then Elijah, after seeing them and it didn't happen, then Elijah prayed to the Lord God, and the Lord answered by fire and consumed the bull and even the water. And Elijah was riding high. It says that Elijah started eliminating the prophets of Baal. It says he started slaughtering them. This guy was a beast. He went from being the prophet, the priest, the preacher, to the warrior. And right after that, it says that the queen of Israel put a death warrant on Elijah's life. And the warrior ran and doubted and went into seclusion. Right after the high point of his ministry and perhaps even his life, he ran away and went into seclusion because he was afraid of the queen, that she might kill him. He expected God to show up. Man, you showed up with fire, so why is this queen now after me? Why doesn't everybody just love me now? Newsflash. The world will never love God's people because the world will never love Jesus. You see it? Do you see it in your life, in your workplace? Do you see it in the world? The world does not love Jesus. Even people who speak about God or speak about going to church, they don't love Jesus. I hear politicians talking about their faith, and then I watch their policies, and I go, that's Antichrist. That's Antichrist. They talk about going to church, but their policies are Antichrist. And there's a reality here. There's another reason that you tried to fix a problem on your own without God, and it didn't work out. And then you lose faith. That's what happened to Moses in Exodus chapter 2. Remember, Moses went out among his, he was raised in the house of the Pharaoh, and he went out amongst his countrymen, and he saw an Israelite slave being beaten by an Egyptian taskmaster. And Moses went to try to protect the Jewish slave, and it wound up that Moses beat and killed the Egyptian taskmaster. But then the Pharaoh had it out for Moses. And the Pharaoh was going to kill Moses. So Moses ran. His strong faith was diminished. And he went into seclusion as a shepherd in the desert of Midian. And then there's a fourth reason why faith wavers. And it's very common in our day. Christians lose faith when they stop kindling the fires of faith. There are four ways to kindle the fire of faith. Faith is kindled by an active presence in the church. Faith glows by a curious mind towards studying the Word of God. Faith is aflame through powerful prayers with sincere believers. And faith is ignited through following Jesus into new territory. In verse 16, Peter is calling God's people to have faith in the name of Jesus, to proclaim the name of Jesus, and to take risks in Jesus' name. But who amongst God's people, will take those risks in the name of Jesus? And who will amongst God's people will have faith in the name of Jesus to proclaim the name of Jesus loudly? Last thing. Verses 17 through 21, the call to repent. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. Verse 18, but what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets that his Christ would suffer, he thus fulfilled. Verse 19, repent therefore and turn back, that your sins may be blotted out. Verse 20, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus. Verse 21, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all the things about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago. It's interesting that Peter says, I know that you acted in ignorance in verse 17. You acted in ignorance. They were ignorant of who Jesus was, that he was the Messiah, that he was the Son of God. So they did not act on Jesus being the Messiah. They rejected him In their ignorance, they did not believe that he was who he said he was. So they rejected him. They scorned him. They mocked him. They beat him. They killed him. When people do not know the truth, they do not act on what the truth requires. That's an important thing. You're here because at some point in your life, you heard truth and you acted on truth to do what truth requires of you. And when you hear the truth, it always requires action. Truth always requires action. Will you say that with me? Truth always requires action. There are plenty of people out there acting on what their version of the truth is or what they believe the truth is. But what if what they believe is a lie? What if what they believe is inconsistent with the Word of God? And now we have Christians that you go, there are so many different sources that you can look to. You go, okay, who am I going to trust? Who's my trusted source for information? And you try to discern who your trusted sources are. Is it the news media that's your trusted source? Well, we know that among all the developed countries of the world, the U.S. news media is the lowest trusted news media in all the planet. Our news media is the least trusted news media in the world. So you would be better off trying to get news by tuning into news from another country, pretty much any other country, than to receive the news from our country. Because most of the news media in our country is spin and lies, and they're trying to twist truth. And so here, when Peter talks about this acting in ignorance, he said, you acted in ignorance. But that's no excuse. I'm speaking the truth to you about who Jesus was. You killed the author of life. That's truth. Now, Peter was calling them to repentance. You acted in ignorance, but now you know the truth. Will you repent? Will you turn the other way? In verse 19 through 20, it says, repent and turn back. And let us turn back to God instead of continuing to turn away from God. Peter promised three results of repentance, and I'm going to give you those three in verses 19 through 21. He said, for those who will repent, those who will turn away from their ignorance, there will be three results that will come to them. And they're recorded in verses 19 through 21. The first is the forgiveness of sins. Now, we've got a problem in our world because the essence of the gospel is the preaching for the forgiveness of sins. That's the essence of the gospel, preaching for repentance, because we need to repent of our sin so that we can receive forgiveness from God. But we live in a world that doesn't want to hear that message. We live even among the churches are adapting the message of the gospel so as not to preach the message of the gospel of forgiveness of sins. We live in a country with many churches that won't utter the word sin from the pulpit. Because people don't want to hear that. People don't relate to that. People don't think that they're bad. People think that they're good. So churches are adapting their message to be a message more like, hey, God wants a good life for you. Hey, God wants you to reach your potential. Hey, God wants you to be healthy. All of those things are true, but that's not the gospel. That's not the gospel. The gospel is that we must repent for the forgiveness of our sins. And then walk in that repentance every day. Because every day we're tempted to fall back into sin. And so we have to kindle the fires of faith. The second thing, the first was the forgiveness of sin, but the second thing that Peter promised here is that there would be times of refreshing. The clearest mark of the messianic age is this times of refreshing as people are refreshed in their spirits. And when the Holy Spirit comes to dwell in the hearts of God's people, the refreshing comes also to the world in general as Christians lived renewed, refreshed lives in a broken and evil world among a dark generation. The refreshing comes as God's people live refreshed lives. And so then the third thing is that he said that he may send the Christ. And this is a reference to the second coming of Jesus. It looks forward to when Jesus Christ will return and his kingdom will be established on earth. And the earth itself would be renewed beyond what it is to a more abundant state, even more abundant than before the fall of Adam and Eve. Look at Romans chapter 8, verses 20 and 21 on your own time. So our response to God must always be a posture of turning back to God, of receiving the truth of God, and of actively pursuing the kingdom of God. Affirmative response to God is the requirement of following Jesus. And so I just want to close out this message by responding to God, that affirmative response, give you this opportunity for an affirmative response. If you'll bow your heads and close your eyes, join me in prayer right now. Our God and our Father, I'm thankful for you and for your goodness and for your power. Lord Jesus, we know that your people, you called us to hear your voice and to receive you for the repentance of sin, for the remission of sin, as we repent, Lord. And I pray, God, that as this room is filled with people who have said, I repent. I need your forgiveness, God, for my sins. Lord, there may be even one person here that has yet to receive you, has yet to receive your name. Whether that person is watching this online at some date or whether they're in this room, I just want to give you the opportunity to go to God with your own words and your own life, just to go to God and let him know that you received Jesus. And it's simple enough. There are no magic words, but it's a posture of saying yes to Jesus. If you want to receive Jesus in your life, it's a posture of saying, yes, Jesus, I want you in my life. Yes, Jesus, I need you in my life. I can't do it on my own. I need you. Will you forgive me of my sins? Will you wash them away? And Lord, will you help me walk in new life? Amen. God bless you, people of God, people of victory. May you live a victorious life filled with his Spirit. And will you join us as we sing right now and the band leads us.
We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of his mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. And we cry, holy, holy, holy. Cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lamb.
We fall down.
We fall down. We lay our crown at the feet of Jesus. Greatness of his mercy and love at the feet of Jesus.
No more fears.
No more fears. You dried our tears at the feet of Jesus. Grace abounds to all who found the feet.
There we go. If anybody accepted Jesus today, that's great news. But it is the first step in a long journey. So let's go ahead and walk that journey together. Please feel free to reach out to any of us who are with you to the end. Now, as we look into this upcoming week, we live in such a divisive time, a time where you just having one simple opinion about something that seems pretty harmless could result in relationships being broken, and nothing's worth that. St. Paul tells us in Romans that we are not to be overcome by evil, but we're to overcome evil with good. So when we are in those situations, we're having those political conversations, let us be mindful that that person who's telling us an opinion that could be just, what is going on over there? They are loved by God. And let's approach them with love and understanding. Let's go ahead and reach out.
No.